found myself tinkering with these Jensen CS315s again. Reason being is it because I'm moving on to the next speaker project, which is going to be a set of RCA three-ways. And so I want to finish these up completely, and then, you know, I'll put them in storage or something like that. Or if any of you are interested in it, you know, hit me up in the comments. I've got more speakers than I need, trust me. So anyway, but yeah, I was not super thrilled with this tweeter, and after listening to it several days, it really tends to be a little bit fatiguing compared to the GRS kind of Marantz replica speaker that I was using in there. So even though I put this Dayton Classic silk dome tweeter in there, and it seemed to pick up the measurement on the, you know, higher end of the frequency range like I wanted it to, and it did sound definitely different, maybe better, but to a point. So throughout my listening with these, I found that when I crank them up, they get a little bit like pitchy sometimes. And the other thing about them is that it just tends to be a tad bright, a little bit fatiguing listening to it for long periods of time, especially if it's louder. When it's quiet, it sounds fine. And in full disclosure, I'm not blaming the tweeters, because these Dayton tweeters are very popular. They get excellent reviews. They're supposed to measure really nice. And there's been tons of DIY projects that have incorporated that tweeter and made it sound super sweet from what people say. But for my own personal liking, I'm going to maybe put those GRS tweeters back in there. They don't look as well, look quite as good, because they're on a steel plate, so they don't stick up off the baffle like this one does to match the rest of it. And the other thing is they don't make it look very modern, but that's okay, because I was actually going for more of a vintage look on these anyway, and I kind of preferred the way that the GRS tweeter added that element. The other thing with the paper cone GRS tweeter is it's actually much larger than this one. It's a 1¾-inch cone, so it's got quite a bit more surface area to it, and it is paper. So I don't know, you know, some people have preferences to paper. I'm one of those people. I found that most of the speakers that I have listened to over the years that have had paper drivers, usually they sound really good. The other ones, the plastic ones, the aluminum ones, I don't know, sometimes they sound great, sometimes they don't. My Energy RC series downstairs, those are Kevlar weave, and those sound nice. I can tell that they're ultra light too, but yeah, so anyway, the GRS is a paper cone, and this is a silk dome that's got some type of a coating on it that makes it super shiny. And I'm going to measure this one speaker. I don't want any kind of weird cone filtering effects or anything else. This tweeter is up off the floor now. I've got it sitting on a box about 12 inches high, and it is almost 3 feet away from the back wall, and almost, it's not quite 1/3 of the way in the room, but it's close to it. So that's kind of that 1/3 rule. It's very close to being 1/3 of the way into the room. And so I'm going to go ahead and run a frequency sweep, and we'll see how it looks. We'll go minus 10 dB, which is what I've been measuring these at this entire time, from beginning to end, is I always wind up at minus 10 dB. So don't mind me, I'm just sitting behind you here, and I'm looking at this graph along with you. As a matter of fact, let me reposition this so that you can see the graph. The speaker up off the floor, it really loses a lot of its 40 hertz punch, it looks like. On the high end, which is what I'm most interested in. Jumps
up here,
right? Yeah, I mean, this is, crossover is here, so it's really picking up steam in here and kind of fading out. And then spiking up right at the crossover again. And then it's just tapers down and then back up again. So not super, super impressive. In the name of experimenting here, let's go. Let's put this guy on the floor and see what happens to that bass. Certainly picked up that bass, didn't it? Crazy. But like I say, I was most interested in where it's crossing over at 5,000. All right, that's green line is set at 5,016 hertz. The other crossover point is at 800. So right in here. Which that crossover, that looks pretty good. This one here, though, is out of whack. And we've got this big spike here, at like 1500 hertz. That's a very sensitive area. All right, so in the name of trying to follow my original plan of just switching out the tweeters, let's go ahead and do that and see what happens, okay? Run it one time and see what happens at the top end. Interesting. It actually brought up that area. All right, so next I want to try it with the Zobel on it. So I'll steal the Zobel off the Dayton tweeter and put it on here. All right, so I'm ready to put this back into the speaker. I actually did both of them while I was at it. So I've got these Zobel networks back on the GRS tweeters. And I'll go ahead and throw those in there. Okay, let's go ahead and run this again. All right, minus 10 dB, and let's watch it compared to the other one. Okay, quite interesting. So it did change a little bit. Let's go ahead and reset this and run it again. And we're back. All right, so I've got both speakers hooked back up now. Got the mic back where it was in the beginning. So we're taking a measurement off both speakers, and I want to see what happens now that both of the GRS tweeters are reinstalled. And these do have the Zobel networks on them. Okay, we'll go the same minus 10 dB. This is pretty wacky, huh? A lot different when both of them are running together. So I think what I'll do next is put them back in the listening position and on the floor, and then remeasure them. Take a music break.
If a picture paints a thousand words, then why can I paint you? The words will never show.
So it doesn't look so bad when we're further away from it. Okay, so I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to run one sweep here with the Dr. Mix, and then we'll play some music, see if it follows the same pattern. And the next thing I might try is putting an attenuator on the mid ranges. I've got a little 2-ohm resistor that I might be able to put on there.
Hi, welcome to Dr. Mix. This is a signal test for you. Enjoy.
Alright, so now we're just going to listen to some music and see if it follows that same pattern of the frequency. Everything to the left of that line, or that green line, everything to the left of it is the woofer. This is all mid-range, and then right about here is a tweeter.
Now I may be drowned in the ocean.
Okay. So these are my two ohm resistors that I'll use as attenuators. Okay, so I did have to fix these. I had to put some smaller terminal ends on them. These are 2 ohm resistors that I'm going to use in series going to the midrange. The reason I put those on backwards, not thinking about it, and this is actually the midrange I had to fix, so I got to be really careful with it. But this is the positive, that's the negative. And I'm running these in reverse. So I still want my positive lead to be attenuated. All right, so that's why I'm doing it on this side. So here we go. Got the red wire with the 2 ohm attenuator, and then I've got my negative here. And this, I suppose, is gonna kind of go down inside of here. And I'm hoping it doesn't get real hot because there is insulation in there. Don't know if that's gonna cause a problem or not. I guess I would smell it if it did, huh? Just want to make sure all the wires are shoved over away from the magnet. Not that I think the magnet's going to cause problems, but because there's such little clearance between the magnet and the inside of the chamber.
That's if the choice were mine to make, but you can make decisions too, and you can have this heart to break.
Well, I'll tell you what's crazy is that they already sound better. I don't know if it's just a placebo effect or what, but it definitely sounds nice.
And this is why my eyes are closed. It's just as well for all I've seen.
Okay, let's go with Dr. Mixer.
All right, so this scale, I've got it more graduated than before. So it's in 5 decibel increments, 20 decibels from 65 to 85. If I shrink this down a little bit, and we go by the 10 decibel increments you're probably used to me using. So it seems, I want to say it brought this mid-range down just a little bit. Could be mistaken, but we'll see. I'll try to run one more of those frequency sweeps from one of the other sources just to double check. Okay, so this part, boy oh boy. I'm going to be talking behind you, and I might be putting some captions in down below to either correct myself or maybe I spot something that I don't see here. But the biggest thing I have a concern with, well, at this point, it does look like this mid-range dropped down just a little bit. It doesn't seem like it changed anything about the tweeter, which is good. It rolls off nice and smooth. And it's pretty even tempered from the tweeter crossover on down to, well, here's the crossover with the woofer between 750 and 800. So it is changing the crossover point a little bit because it's a different resistance, and my Zobel network is not dialed in perfect for that speaker any longer, because I did add that resistor, but it's behaving fairly well. The woofer, not so much. I mean, it's a 15-inch woofer. We're in an open environment, and they're sitting on the floor. I got all kinds of excuses, don't I? The, you know, it's two of them running together, obviously, but this is, I think, out of anything on this woofer that Ken I don't like is from 50 to 80, it has got a giant suck out. And by giant, I'm talking 10, 12, like 14 dBs. If we go from peak to peak, it's even more than that. So that's a big chunk of information that we're missing here. And so yeah, that's pretty wild. Let's put our pointer there. That's let's split it right in the middle. So say 70 hertz. Let's see what kind of musical information is at 70 hertz that we're gonna be missing out on.
Never saw it come until the rain became an endless storm, an ending born. When the waters rose, you climbed to higher ground to watch for signs of grand designs to save us. It's time to find a way to flood the fate was always in the current anyhow. Now don't you cry. Oh no, you know we're just always on a ship. Temporary lights.